The buttons have been pushed. The light is staying green. Odds are we're on the internet.
Uh-oh.
See how long it takes to gather an audience. Uh-oh. The lights went yellow. The lights went yellow. The lights went red. We're in trouble.
Oops.
I don't know what to do to find out what's wrong with the lights. Looking at.
There you are. Were showed 527.
Oh, the lights not only went red, they've got a no sign in them.
Did you lose control of the channel?
My problem is that I don't really know what it means. Oh, are the lights green again? No, the lights are very red. Just for fun. We'll go see what's actually streaming, if anything.
Yeah, we're there.
On YouTube?
On the YouTube.
It says live. We'll go see what's actually streaming, if anything. Yes, we're now in the never-ending loop here. Yeah,
that's it. I think it's cold here.
Okay, so the YouTube seems to be working, so it must be Facebook that's giving me the red. Let's find out. Facebook says live. It says live. Facebook says live. Everybody seems to be working
live.
Facebook says live. I don't know why it's red. Well, whatever. So it's you and me, Jim, and here to promote the upcoming show tomorrow night. Well, tomorrow night as it appears from where we are now, which is about almost 8:40 p.m. Saturday night. In the Eastern time zone, 5:40 p.m. where you are.
Yep. Not quite dinner time.
And the show coming up will be live Sunday, 7 p.m. Pacific, 10 p.m. Eastern, still 0200 Zulu. We haven't crossed our change from daylight saving time to standard time. That's in a couple of weeks. And then we'll become 0300 Zulu, just like magic. And on this Sunday's show is going to be Larry K7HN, who does the Ham Radio Live YouTube show almost every freaking day.
Excellent.
I guess he doesn't have a lot of other stuff to do. Well, actually, I know he has one other major thing to do. He takes care of his brother, who requires pretty much constant care. So that's a pretty amazing thing to do. But in his spare time, he does a YouTube show. He does it like an old-time radio show. He just sits, he does the weather, but it's not meteorological weather. It's space weather.
I love that, because otherwise you got to wait every week for the space weather woman and you forget half of what's going on unless you're taking notes. So yeah, it's nice to see this in current form.
I don't understand any of that. For as long as I've been a ham, I've never really understood the A index, the K index. There are sunspots and that's good, but then there are sunspots and that's bad. Every once in a while, I try to delve into it and understand it, and it just gives me a headache.
Yeah, well, when she tells you amateur radio operators in North America are going to have a really bad time on Saturday, she's probably pretty close to right.
Okay.
On some bands in some directions.
Yeah. And I guess there's ways to figure out if the band's open, a band, to where it might be open, I guess. I mean, I just, these days I don't have a home station, but when I'm out in the car, I'll turn on the ICOM 7000 and tune around. I'll start at 10 meters. If 10 meters is open, that's cool. If it's not, I'll listen for WWV and see, you know, usually I can hear it on it. At 15 megahertz, if I can hear it at 25 megahertz, then 10 meters has got a pretty good chance of being open. And, but 15 is pretty routine. 10 is pretty routine.
Right.
And, if I hear some folks on, 15 meters, maybe there's nobody there. I'll try 17 meters. There's nobody there. I'll try 20. There's usually somebody on 20 or 40. And that makes me happy. I don't need to know that the band is open to Asia from California, I guess.
Yeah, well, that's what was interesting about traveling across country and encountering propagation from different parts of the country and different bands and different days. It's like, wow, you guys can work Europe from over there. That never happens here.
Yeah, that's true. The propagation is very different. You guys can get Asia, and we just about never can. Hawaii is even hard from here. Hawaii is a chip shot for you guys, I believe.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's cool. I mean, I follow a couple of 40 meter and a couple 20 meter nets, and so I can pretty much tell, well, am I going to have morning coffee with the guys in the Midwest or not? Nope. Okay. Well, turn that off and go back to something else. It's just not going to happen.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm being told that we are buffering and The red lights turn yellow. That's better than red, I guess. So even though we are making it to the YouTubes and the Facebooks, it's not good. And now it's red and it's got the no sign again. So and I'm recording this. If the playback is bad, I'll just replace the signal. Let me see how bad it sounds. If the playback is bad, I'll just replace the signal. Let me see how bad it sounds. If the playback is bad, I'll just replace the
the never ending loop
signal. Let me see how bad it sounds. If the playback is bad, I'll just replace
the never ending loop
signal. That's Facebook, so that seems to be doing okay. So maybe it's YouTube that's the problem. It doesn't happen often enough for me to really understand when it's not working, what the problem is with it not working.
YouTube looks good. I mean, it spins the little buffering dial for a couple seconds out here, but let's see what Facebook is doing.
Yeah. Ed says, blame it on the sun. So I guess I could go learn what they mean when it's red and stuff. Well, anyway, we're just here to tell you to tune in tomorrow, but I won't do a show unless I get green lights. If I stop and try to start again, it's a major enterprise.
Yeah. Different session and all that.
Yep.
Well, this ought to be pretty exciting. I mean, it's nice to see. We don't get a lot of daily news except some of the spotter groups or whatever on Facebook or some of the other discussion groups to find out what's going on. And we've had there are a couple of groups that somebody says, "Well, 10 meters is really open today," and everybody's going, "Where are you?" Because it doesn't matter if it's open if you're 3,000 miles away from everybody who wants it to be open.
Yeah.
So we're trying to change that behavior of where things are going, but it's it also helps to look at some of the whisper plots and see what's, you know, some of the beacons and things like that. And if all else fails, pick one of the web SDRs and see where it is.
Yeah, or just do what I do: turn the radio on, see what you can hear, have fun, talk to them.
Yeah.
Some people need to know more. I want to get in on some extreme Elmering that I've been doing on Facebook. You have your own Facebook Elmering group.
Yes, Amateur Radio Elmers. Started about 2016, about 6,700 members.
And people ask lots of questions.
Not as many as we'd like, but once in a while we stir things up and get some things going. I sent out a poll to kind of query what people wanted to know about so I can start formulating some material and looking for some content to reference.
There are others, probably a bunch of others. There's one in particular, I'm thinking new ham radio, new to hobby or something like that, that gets questions every day. And it pops up in my Facebook feed fairly often, probably because I go and answer questions. And I've picked out a couple that I think were entertaining.
There's a lot of the usual questions about what coax is best, what antenna is best, you know, all the best questions. Yeah.
That are really hard to answer.
It goes right up there with great antenna and, you know, the great radio, you know, myth because of purple display. And so it takes a while to, you know, to really give good answers, not have things go off in the weeds. You've got to be able to figure out answering, you know, asking some qualifying questions to figure out where things are coming from. Because if somebody says, I'm getting interference in the TV in the living room, the immediate, you know, answer is, well, just put some ferrites on it and you'll be good. Well, let's try and figure out where the problem is coming from and then qualify the station build. And usually if people straighten out their station build, then you know, the problem goes away. So it's qualifying things, which is why I started the group, because there are so many groups that are not qualifying the answers and people are just saying, throw ferrites at it and you'll be good.
Yeah. And you probably do a pretty good job of moderating the bad answers, I would guess.
Well, you know, if a really off the wall answer comes up, I try to make sure that we don't call anybody out for, you know, that was a really stupid answer to the question. It doesn't help because that doesn't do any good. When you get some of our, there's some peers, there's some subject matter expert qualification that's behind some of this. So when two or three of us who think we've been around for a while, and I know a couple of guys have, when they come up with the actual factual, you know, answer, you know, we just let the not so appropriate answers fade into the background. If somebody says something really stupid or derogatory, then, you know, then we pull it, because that's the one premise I have is that it's global. It's, you know, all ages, all everything. We're here for a technical purpose, not a personal purpose. And, you know, that's how we're going to behave.
How do you handle it if an answer is somewhere between not helpful and 180 wrong, but sincerely believed by the person who posted it?
Well, again, that's where coming into, sometimes you've got to say, well, contrary to or different from some answers, myths, legends, beliefs, whatever else. And like I said, it's kind of a passive response to that. Yeah. We've seen six answers here that aren't quite right. Let's help figure out why those answers come up, which is a big part of it. But, and that's what really got me into this is I got into HF. I'm looking at all the stuff that I thought I learned from being a kid hanging around serious HF people. And I'm going, that's not quite the right, you know, behavior of this circuit or what's going on here. And so you got to dig a little bit deeper and go, I know why I thought that at the time when I was building a dipole or putting up a station, and then, you know, learned that, oh, if I didn't do something stupid and did something right, the station worked a lot better. So you can give some, you know, some case answers and go, well, yeah, well, we've tried that and this was the result. And this is the actual, sometimes you have to identify the symptom, the problem, and that is whatever construct you're describing for your antenna run or your coax or your station build. You can pretty much break that down into specifics that there are stray currents running here, you're missing a ground here, you've got a ground loop there, et cetera, and give somebody a visual picture in their mind of take the blinders off, take the sunshades off, and go look at a clearer picture of what's actually happening in the circuit. And they go, oh, hey, I did what you said, and that worked great. Yep. Okay, another one, another win for the team that's really trying to get people, on board. And, the lurkers who, may have been spreading some of the myths, hopefully, they'll either disappear or very few people come up and argued with the correct answer, because I think they shrunk back in a chair and went, I'm not going to admit I was stupid, but I'm going to go fix my station now.
Yeah,
and that's okay. And I don't want to, you were stupid. You just didn't know. And I know how you come to not know. And it's a lot of stuff that's on the a lot of the old social media and myths and legends. And some, sometimes what some of the people before us have responded with are a correct answer to what they want you to do is correct, but how they explain how it works is not. So, Steve was right. This is what you do, and this is why you do it. Again, without calling Steve out, contrary with Steve's justification for it, but acknowledge, hey, somebody's tried to help, and this is the actual perspective of help, and that's. And you also have to think in terms of, and I know a lot of groups, probably more public, non-technical groups, but you'll see it in amateur radio every so often that people say, well, that question was asked and answered 12 months ago. Why are we still having this question come up every 3 months? And I just go back and liken it to, imagine you're a fifth grade geometry teacher in middle school. You start the same course every September. Yeah. And you've got a whole new batch of students that are going to get 2 weeks into it and go, Ms. Smith, I don't understand this question. I can't figure out the answer. And if that teacher said, I've been teaching for 9 years, I've already answered that question 9 years ago. I'm not going to answer it again. That teacher needs to get fired and, go work in a cafeteria or something. So just imagine, we're doing a recurring class every day on the same thing, just like a teacher will every year, year in, year out, to bring people up to speed. And that seems to help.
Yeah, that helps me because I do get frustrated, I guess, a little bit that the same questions seem to come up all the time. And that makes sense. Searching for the right answer through a YouTube group, you can do it, but it's not easy. And it's really a lot easier just to ask that question again.
Well, and that's interesting. And sorry, I missed last week's show because I think the project of curation of things about this hobby is going to be very, very important. That's something I'm trying to do when I find new things to put on my web pages and refer people to. Is there's the right things that people ought to know, and there's everything that's appeared in every version of QST Ham Radio 73 for, 20 years, 30, 40, 50 years. And you want to pick the best of the best that is easily readable, is from a subject matter expert that does a good job of explaining it without going into the weeds with math or science. And yeah, of course those questions are going to come up. Again and again and again, be it setting up a Pi Star node and you figure out whether somebody knows about RF or the internet. And, we have to go back and answer questions about how the internet works, just like dipoles and everything else. And when you see enough of those, which is one of the reasons I put out a poll for our group, is what do you guys really, really want to know about? And I put in a bunch of multiple choice pieces and let people write things in. And interestingly enough, first HF antennas was the leader of the pack. So that says, all right, go back and grab all the curated material, Maybe it's time to go in the backyard with a video camera and the antenna analyzer and actually do some of this stuff and show folks. So, or, you know, go find a subject matter expert as a guest to say, hey, you know, can you explain the first HF antenna for people in this condition or that condition? And we'll see what we get. Cause I don't claim to be the expert in everything. I can give you the right answer, but I don't have any credentials. I'd rather have it come from a double E who's done RF at HP or Rockwell or, you know, some other cool place.
Yeah. Whenever I see that, what's the first antenna, HF antenna, I just go grab the, one of the early episodes we did on Ham Radio Now with my friend Jeff, AC4ZO, now Silent Key, called Dipole. And we build a dipole and we feed it with twin lead and it works on all bands. It's long enough, you know, it's 120 feet, I think.
You built a doublet.
Well, I guess I don't know what a doublet is. This is just a dipole with twin lead feed and requires a tuner, which when I was a brand new ham, I was told a tuner is a terrible idea. And, now I realize that was bad advice. Tuner is a great idea.
It is. And if you look at all the rage now, and it's interesting since, I had my general and got an HF rig and somebody handed me a G5 RV. You know, I've been through, all the possible research on Luis's antenna experiment and unfortunately lost to history because apparently a friend of his edited his rendition of Luis's history. Luis never wanted that antenna to be named after him, but he was certainly proud of
that. That must be the guy whose call sign was G5 RV.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I'm sorry. Yeah. And, you know, I've read all the articles I can find about the guy and, you know, it was a 20 meter doublet and that twin lead is not the feed line. It is actually part of the antenna. He calls it a matching section and it does require a tuner. And I don't know.
People keep saying it doesn't. People say it's an all band antenna, but it's not.
No. If you look at the impedances, it comes close on 20 meters where he's designed it, but back when he built that antenna, there was some impedance matching between the antenna and the transmitter finals. And we don't have that now except rigs with auto tuners. And I wish we could figure out something. Well, I guess Johnson coined the best phrase with the Matchbox product. Rather than calling it an antenna tuner, because if you're going to be an antenna tuner, that would be me in a tree with some wire cutters.
Yep. And, or wire stretchers.
Yeah, wire stretchers. So, you know, those are some of the things. And if you look at the now, we went through the period where the off-center fed dipole was all the rage. And then that kind of faded off. And now everybody's into the all-band end-fed half-wave, which is maybe a half-wave only on one frequency and has compensation, you know, operated off its half-wave frequency, you need a matching system. And then you get into there's a harmonic relationship between 80 meters and 40 meters and 20 meters. You know, the numbers don't work out. And so W8JI and someone else, I've written a paper about this, have gone through and studied and said, all right, if you want this to work, you know, here's a little counterpoise section. Here's a different little matching compensating network to add to your balun. And then it will be an all band piece of wire. It won't be half wave, on all those bands, but it will be an all band piece of wire. And, that's just one of the experiments I need to get out in the backyard and build is find 132 feet of space and go stretch some wire and illustrate this. And it's working out for a lot of people who've got, even if they can only do, you know, 40 meters worth, it's getting people on the air because you can stick the thing in your backyard and not have it too high off the ground. And a lot of people are really enjoying it. They may not know why they're enjoying it, but at least it's working for them. So, you know, the soda and POTA folks have certainly proven that, yes, you can make contact. So it's not a bad all-purpose antenna.
So what would you call an antenna tuner rather than an antenna tuner? Or what did Johnson say?
Johnson calls their product a matchbox.
Okay. So yeah, I maybe a better term, more generic term would be antenna system tuner.
Impedance compensation.
Yeah.
It's the technical term. Yep. Because, yeah. So that's, you know, that's a term we'll probably never get rid of. We'll never see all the product branding change from being an antenna tuner. You know,
I'm not even sure, what it says on the front of my MFJ949E. It's right back there. I could look. It's probably in this picture behind me somewhere. I could look.
Yeah, I've got a couple of them around here. And, you know, my HF rig in the truck on its whip has got a got an SG230 auto tuner. And they call it an auto tuner. And I guess we're stuck with the phrase, even though that's not what it's doing. But, you know, that's okay. I'd rather not be pedantic about that phrase, except to mention it, you know, that this is not what you're really doing. And then move on to making sure all the rest of the system is intact and proper for good operation, good clean operation, and not wiping out the iPads in the house.
Well, I got a couple of questions that I've answered in the past couple of weeks on, maybe they were all on the new ham. One of them might've been a GMRS forum. I don't know. I got a couple of them I pulled out and I'm proud of my answer and thought the questions were good. So I stuck them in our show doc and maybe we'll have a chance to get to them. They've been pending in that show doc now for a couple of weeks. The information hasn't changed. So
somebody just hasn't read them.
We've had good long shows that were chock full of other stuff and haven't gotten to that. And we'll see.
Yeah, maybe we ought to go through, either let the audience help us with a top 10 list or, we'll all go vote on what we want to address as the top 10 of big ideas like that and just nail them.
Yeah. Between you and me and David, we have all the knowledge of ham radio there is in the world. So.
At our fingertips. Yes.
As long as there's a Google nearby.
Well, I've got the phone number of some very, very good engineers and, and there are a lot of references, a lot of personalities out there. Dave Kessler, is it? He does some very good, videos and primers. I was just watching, I missed part of it, but a primer on using, Easy Neck for antenna modeling and moving elements around and seeing how they behave. It's a little complicated for some folks, but I think I'll go back and watch it again in the tutorial part and find out, because there's some things I want to model that I haven't figured out where all the wires go and what all the, you know, what it's kind of complicated. But it was amazing to watch a couple hours of that video this afternoon and see, you know, how a Yagi behaves when you move a wire around or change elements or change height. And that if I could get the guy who did that tutorial and maybe frame in a, let's talk about how a couple of common antennas work and show the world graphically through Easy Neck how that works, that might be a very educational kind of thing to do. So, you know, there's no ends of things to try to do. It's all the time to you know, really, really put it into, you know, some production value.
Yeah. If we get into that, I'll be glad to sit back here and push the buttons and let somebody explain it. I've seen the term for that calculator. And once again, I think I must've skipped those questions on my extra test.
Oh, I don't think they asked about the product specifically, but the characteristics is really fascinating. And, you know, I'm looking at it going, that explains why that antenna had to get fixed this way when I had problems with it, you know, 10 years ago. Okay. You know, I'm kind of sold in what people can know about this and what you can see. And, you know, some people are, well, we have this thing about visual learners and otherwise, but sometimes you just got to get, you know, get the Legos and the Tinker Toys out and start connecting the dots and stacking things up and go, you know, that's how it works. Some people like to see it in math because they can understand plus J0 minus 72 ohms reactive. And I can't visualize that.
Yeah. I remember answering a question sometime about changing the length of your coax to get a better match to an antenna. And somebody slapped me down saying, no, if you put that on a Smith chart, it'll just go around in a circle and never reach 52 ohms. So you don't know what you're talking about. I've never given that answer again.
Well, you know, transmission line is supposed to be transparent. And so, you know, if you've got 52 ohm coax and a 75 ohm antenna, there's there's a big ball of mishmash going on up at the antenna, and that's going to reflect back back to the transmitter. How you take care of that is, well, I don't think anybody makes a 1.5 to 1 ballon. So, you know,
you can make your own.
But you know, a 75 ohm antenna into most of our radios isn't going to be a big deal. And then you get into SWR anxiety, which, you know, I see a lot of people hyperventilating about that and trying to say, oh, I got 1.1 to 1 SWR. And I go, do you know how inaccurate your test equipment is? Because that's almost impossible. And, you know, so, I mean, even a bird watt meter is off 10 to 15% at either end of the dial. So figuring out what's going on with a professional instrument versus some things and, you know, those kinds of myths. I mean, one point, the difference in working somebody or not is not had between 1.1 to 1 SWR and 1.5 or 2 to 1 SWR. There's just not that much loss difference in the, so I've got tables and all that. There's a whole article I'm writing about SWR anxiety too, which ought to be really thrilling when it gets published.
Two to one does not mean half your power is being reflected back.
That's correct.
It's significantly less than that. And 3 dB is barely noticeable.
Well, it's half an S unit. And, I guess if you're in bad enough conditions, maybe 3 dB getting above some of the noise can help, but, I'm sitting here looking at the noise floor and all the stuff in my flex going, I can see somebody down there at, you know, in the noise, and 3 dB is not going to bring him above ambient noise enough for copy. Now, if it was CW, you know, that'd be a different story, but to get all the voice articulation out of 3 dB is not going to happen.
Yep. We're still red over there. I'm looking at YouTube, and it's, What does it seem like?
It's really fascinating. And, you know, I'm looking at it going,
you seem good. I don't know where we're bad. I don't know where our problem is. I'll go play back some and see. It's an educational experience what things look like. But and we'll look at some of those Elmer questions, and maybe we'll do some more direct Elmering shows down the road.
I've got a whole list of things that I hope we can, you know, try to condense into an hour of coverage one way or the other.
You and David were doing kind of that when I was gone, weren't you?
Yeah, we brought on, at least we started with Ward Silver and grounding, and we're still due to do a follow-up, you know, from the ground up, because he's also, you know, an antenna expert and genius. And, you know, those are the kinds of things, is to find that quality, that recognizable, approachable kind of talent to, you know, provide some very focused answers on very common dilemmas. And then when somebody asks that question for the 10th time this month, you can say, you can answer the question and say, if you really want to know more, here's a whole hour of video that will really explain it to you better than we can hear in words. And,
yeah,
you know, that's why I'm interested in the curation project. And how they're going to index that and figure out if there's any kind of content quality ranking behind it. Because, again, you can curate the whole stack of...
I don't think they're going to do that.
Yeah.
I don't think they're...
But it would be nice externally to try and do that.
Yeah, I think what they're going to do is they'll take print material and get optical character recognition so that it's text readable, which means it's indexable. And if you go do a search for it, they can pull out the words and find it in that, from that print material, which is good. I don't think anyone's going to do a quality evaluation for the stuff they get, because I just think it's going to be way too much.
Yeah. See how fast the library builds up. But I think, you know, I mean, that's what a lot of us are doing anyway. When some subject comes up, you know, Google's my friend, so I was looking through the ARRL for information, all that, and I'm going to look at 6 or 8 articles and go, the approach in this response to this subject is a good match in context and approach to answer, you know, so many questions in a good, successful manner. Again, why reinvent the wheel? We've got, you know, 100 years of expertise out here, and certainly a great deal of expertise since we actually learned about, you know, got real test equipment since World War II. We know a lot more than we did 100 years ago.
Yep. All right. So everybody, tomorrow night, 7 p.m. Pacific, 10 p.m. Eastern, 0200 Zulu. We'll talk to Larry K7HN about his YouTube show, and maybe he'll bring us our own custom space weather forecast.
Cool. We'll see. That'll be exciting.
All right.
And he can explain it to you.
He can try to make me understand. That would be worthwhile and probably not successful, but we will find out. All right. See you tomorrow night, Jim.
All right.
Good night, everybody. Over and out. No, wait a minute. Over.
And?
Out. There we go.
We need the gnome. We need the gnome to have a voice.
Oh, the gnome has a voice. He sounds like this.
Oh, then he can do out.
Out. Over.
Out.
And?
Out.
Out. We're back. And we're back. And we're gone.